Hello everyone, my name is Emdy and welcome to episode 3 of my Practical Redstone series. I put a poll on my community page a while back letting you choose what this episode will focus on. And it was close, but by popular demand, we'll focus on hoppers, droppers, and dispensers in this video. As always, this is what you'll see in vanilla. And this is what they'll look like in this video, thanks to the Redstone tweaks pack. First up, the hopper. Hoppers are immovable non-conductive blocks, which have a slightly different shape depending on how you place it. When placing a hopper, the spout faces into the block you placed it against, leading to 5 possible orientations. A hopper has 2 main functions, item pickup and item transfer. It also has 5 inventory slots, so it can also store some items. A hopper has 1 input being the area above it, and 1 output that is dependent on where the spout is facing. Every hopper in the world is what's known as a ticking block entity, which means it is a block that when loaded, will run certain checks every tick no matter what. A tile entity, now called a block entity, is a block that stores more data than what can be put in the simple block states you can see in F3, and the data is stored in the form of NBT or named binary tags. But that information isn't important to this series. This makes them very taxing on the server in high quantities, and therefore can be big lag causers. The game makes a list of all the loaded ticking block entities and executes them in order. This order is determined by the order they were placed, but changes on reload depending on the location it is saved to your hard drive. But for all practical purposes, it can be thought of as randomized. I'll be using the Simplified flowchart by cubic meter to explain hoppers and item transfer, but there are more in-depth resources over on the Storage Tech Discord if you are interested. When a hopper is ticked, it first reduces its cooldown by 1. We'll come back to this. Then, if the hopper is not powered and not on cooldown, it will check if it's empty. Otherwise, it stops right there and moves to the next hopper. If the hopper is empty, it goes to this step, which we'll come back to. Otherwise, it looks for the first item in the hopper and searches for an empty slot in the block the hopper points into. If the destination is an empty hopper, it transfers the item and sets both the destination hopper and itself to a cooldown of 8 game ticks. If it's not a hopper, or if it's a hopper with items, then it just transfers and sets its own cooldown. If either there is no destination inventory, or the transfer was successful, then the hopper checks if it is full. If yes, the checks just proceed to the next hopper. If no, then the hopper tries to pull an item either as an entity from the block above or an inventory above it. If either is successful, the hopper sets its cooldown to 8 game ticks and then proceeds to the next hopper. If they fail, then it skips to the next one anyway. The important things to remember from this are, in the same game tick, a hopper will push an item before it tries to pull in items. But then you may be wondering why in a setup like this, it doesn't go into the top chest. This is because when the top hopper picks up an item, it puts itself in cooldown, while the one below is still active. Hence, it can't push the item into the chest before the hopper below sucks it up. A hopper will not perform the further laggier checks if it is powered. If you become familiar with Storage Tech and its community, you will often hear people telling you to lock your hoppers. This means that when your contraption is not running, it is advisable to have as many of the hoppers in it be powered, because powered hoppers are the least laggy out of any configuration. A hopper has a cooldown of 8 game ticks between each item transfer, which means a single hopper can only transfer 9,000 items per hour. There is an interesting case of these kinds of setups, where a hopper points into the one below. You may think that it will still transfer one item every 8 game ticks, but this is not the case. Since the top hopper only sets the cooldown of the hopper below if the hopper below is empty, the first item transfers normally, but then every 8 game ticks after that, the cooldowns are set independently, so the top hopper empties twice as fast as normal. A hopper will not check for item entities if it has a block with an inventory above. the check for item entities is more server intensive than the inventory check. So covering your hoppers with blocks that have inventories is also good for the server. The best block for this case is the composter, since it only has one slot for the hopper to check. The next best option is droppers or dispensers with 9 slots. Furnaces and brewing stands aren't recommended, since they are ticking block entities themselves. When transferring an item, the hopper tries to transfer the items from its slots in order. So it first tries slot 1, if that fails, then slot 2, then slot 3, and so on. It will attempt to transfer the selected item into the first slot it can in the destination container. If the item can stack, that would be the first empty slot or a non-empty stack of that item type. And if it's a full stack, it tries the next slot. For non-stackables and non-matching items, it finds the first empty slot and moves the item there. When a hopper is pulling an item from a container above, it is the same situation. It picks each slot in order and the item transfers into the hopper if it is a matching item in a non-full stack or an empty slot. There are three main blocks that have different inputs depending on the side you point the hopper or dropper. The first are the furnace variants. They have three slots, a smelting item input, a fuel input, and a product slot. A hopper or dropper pointing into the top can put items in the smelting item input, while a hopper or dropper pointing into any of the sides of the block can only put valid fuel items in the fuel slot. A hopper on the bottom can pull items from the output and no other slot. A brewing stand is next, and it has 5 slots, an ingredient slot, a blaze powder slot, and 3 potion slots. Hoppers and droppers pointing into the top of the stand can only transfer valid brewing items, unlike when they are on the side, in which case they can only transfer potion bottles and blaze powder. A hopper below the stand can empty the potion slots in order from left to right. The last block is simply the composter, where it has no interaction on the sides, but simply input above and output below. Since hoppers check for items in the block above them, they can also pick up items that just barely intersect with that space. For example, a honey block, which is not quite a full block, will still allow items to be picked up by a hopper below it if the items are against the side or top. This is useful in item storage, where water streams or ice baths are used. If the items are aligned against blocks like honey, ender chests, which have an inventory but hoppers still pick up items through it, because it's not an inventory they can access, cakes, anvils, sea pickles, etc. Then when the items are sent along ice, they get the speed of the ice but can still be picked up by the hoppers. This also ensures that items do not get stuck in the bowl of the hopper. Next, we have droppers and dispensers. I'll cover these together because they have a lot of similarities. Both droppers and dispensers can be placed anywhere and have 6 directions they can face, with them pointing towards you when placed. Droppers can be identified by the semicircular smile-like output on their face. Dispensers, on the other hand, have circular openings. When facing up or down, droppers have rectangular openings, while dispensers have circular ones. Droppers are used to transfer items into containers, convert items from inventory back to entity form, and sometimes used as randomizers. Dispensers are used for a variety of things. They have special interactions with certain blocks, depending on the items in them. For example, they can place down shulker boxes, pick up honey from bee nests, apply bone meal to saplings, and much more. Droppers and dispensers, when powered, change their triggered state immediately, but they don't actually perform their action until 4 game ticks later. This means the fastest you can have a dropper or dispenser perform an action is in 4 game tick intervals. Droppers and dispensers also get powered slightly different to most other blocks. commonly called quasi-connectivity, or QC. This is the mechanic of droppers, dispensers, and pistons to get activated by things that would activate the block above it. Think of them as the lower half of doors. Anything that would power the top or bottom half of a door in the same space would power the dropper, dispenser, or piston. The door analogy actually makes sense when you know why this mechanic existed. When these components were added, Minecraft was in very early stages, with limited existing components. So instead of coding the power and code manually, all that was done was the code from the door was copied over to these, at the time new blocks. But instead of patching it, the devs actually kept the bug because the community found it really useful, so it is kept as a feature. While the QC blocks should be powered, they will not realize it if they aren't given a block update. For example, if I power this block with a repeater, it only sends updates to these blocks. So the dropper doesn't realize it's powered even though it should be. This can be fixed by using blocks like node blocks or power rails that give out updates when powered. Any other source of an update works as well, though I won't be including them as part of this lesson. When a dropper gets activated, it picks a random item in its inventory to spit out. The item spawns in front of the dropper in the direction the dropper is facing, with forward velocity, meaning it goes forward in the direction the dropper faces. However, this is not a straight line. The item gets a random offset velocity, so you'll find them spraying out a little bit. You can use blocks like powder snow or cobwebs to tame the item trajectories. This item is picked out of the total slots filled, so if only one slot has items, that will be the item spat out every time. But if two slots are filled, the chance of one of the slots being selected to spit out an item is 1 in 2 or 50%. If all the slots are filled, it is 1 in 9. Therefore, droppers can be used as randomizers. When a dropper is facing a container with an inventory, it tries to transfer the item to it, instead of spitting the item out. If it cannot transfer the item, it stays in the dropper without noise. If it transfers the item, it also makes no noise. But if an empty dropper is activated, or it spits out an item, it will click. It is therefore possible to make silent item elevators, if the powering and updating is done correctly. This also works horizontally, and in both cases with some tricks of update order. It can be used to make instant dropper lines that span vast distances, transferring an item from one end to the other in a single tick. Dispensers also follow the same slot selection system, and like droppers, can spit out most items. They cannot transfer items into other containers though. Dispensers have special interactions with other items. With pieces of armor, or the elytra, a dispenser will attempt to equip it to a player, mob, or armor stand whose hitbox intersects with the block in front of the dispenser. If it cannot do so, it simply spits out the item. Speaking of armor stands, a dispenser will also place them in the block in front of them. Arrows of any kind in a dispenser will be fired in the direction the dispenser faces. Boats will be placed in the world as entities if the dispenser is facing water or a waterlogged block, or if it's air with water or a waterlogged block below. Failure to do so results in an item entity. Bone meal will be used as if the player was interacting with the block in front of the dispenser with bone meal. So it works for things like moss, saplings, nether vines, lichen, fungi, and more. Projectiles like eggs, snowballs, and bottles of enchanting fire in the direction of the dispenser. Splash and lingering potions do the same, although they fire further than a player would throw. Empty buckets and dispensers can be used to pick up liquids or powder snow in front of them. Likewise, dispensers can empty the contents of filled buckets in front of them. If it cannot do so, the item is spat out. If the dispenser is full and there is no space for the now filled bucket that is unstackable, then the filled bucket is shot out. Fire charges shoot like blaze fireballs, which set fire to the blocks or entities they collide with. Hence, they can be used to light nether portals. Flint and steel create fire in front of the dispenser and can also be used to light portals. Firework rockets fire in the direction of the dispenser. Mineguards will be placed if the dispenser is facing a rail or its variants, otherwise dropped. Carved pumpkins will be placed as blocks if the dispenser thinks it will complete the structure for an iron or snow golem. The detection of the structure is not perfect and depends on the direction. Mobs and player heads will try to be equipped to an entity. Failure to place or equip carved pumpkins or heads just results in the dispenser failed click. Shulker boxes are placed as blocks. Spawn eggs will summon the mob in front of the dispenser. TNT will be summoned as an entity with an activated fuse in front of the dispenser with a small random velocity upwards. Shears will attempt to be used on sheep, mushrooms, and snow golems whose hitbox intersects with the block in front. If facing a full beehive or nest, the dispenser will harvest honeycomb, and the honeycomb item will spawn inside of the beehive or nest. Horse armor will be put on tamed horses. Saddles will be put on mobs that allow it, like pigs, mules, donkeys, striders, and horses. Carpet is equipped to llamas. Chests will be equipped to llamas, donkeys, and mules. If facing a respawn anchor, glowstone will be used to charge the anchor. Honeycomb in a dispenser facing copper blocks will be used to wax the copper. Water bottles can convert dirt variants into mud, and empty bottles can get filled with water if facing a block with water and not a cauldron, or filled with honey if facing a full beehive or nest. That's pretty much all there is to it, so now we have the challenges. Number 1, a block update detector. Make a block update detector with all the blocks we've learned so far, and make it reusable so it resets itself. Number 2, double speed item filter. With your knowledge of item transfer hoppers, make an item filter that can sort 18,000 items per hour with a single hopper as an input, and then try to make it one wide and able to be placed side by side, also known as tileable. Number 3, silent dropper chains. Make a long winding chain of droppers and wire them so that an inputted item reaches the end as fast as possible. Some other things you can try as personal projects are different kinds of item filters, like non-stackable filters. You can also try specialized filters for certain non-stackables by using their special properties. Smart droppers, which are droppers that get powered by a clock only when they have items in them. Try both single hopper and double hopper speed. Potion brewers and furnace arrays, but these can be a bit more advanced, so try them if you are confident in your abilities. But that marks the end of the video. Questions, submissions, and feedback are welcome on the NubTech Discord server. I've started making challenge explanations for these episodes on my second channel, Emdy Extras, and the first video will be out shortly, so do check them out if they interest you. With that out of the way, I want to thank you for watching. I hope you found it useful, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye!